Well, it's been a long time since I was spoken at a communist event. When I came in through airport security, I debated whether to explain why I was visiting the UK. And probably the saddest part of it is, if I said I was speaking at a Communist Party event, he wouldn't care. You were laughing at that? You're here too. Speaking of irrelevances. I am coming here en route from Punta Cana, Dominican Republic, and if you're wondering how I ended up there, I was wondering the same thing. It wasn't an airport hijacking. A fellow I knew when he was 5 years old and through ages 12. I worked in a community center in a tough neighborhood, and he's now 41 and he was on to his second marriage, which he decided to hold in Punta Cana, Dominican Republic. And I felt an obligation to be there because I was kind of his surrogate father when he was growing up. And it was the first vacation of my life, literally. It was the first vacation of my life. And it was so terrible. It's a vacation resort. Has anyone here been to these like vacation resorts? Raise your hand. Don't be ashamed. You have. You know, you can be thrown out of the party for that. But it was all either families or young couples. And for 3 days, I literally did not talk to anyone. No one wanted to talk to me because they were just with their significant other or their family. It's like being in prison. But I left there more resolute than ever in my conviction that the communists of old had it right. We have to smash the nuclear family. I spent an arm and a leg and had misery as a consequence. That's all by way of a long introduction, irrelevant, as is the Communist Party, to the topic this afternoon, which is really two interrelated but discrete topics. And given time limitations, I was expecting to go on for 2.5 hours in Fidel Chavez style, but I was told I have to limit myself to the democratic constraint of 40 minutes so the masses have an opportunity to interject their irrelevancies. So I'll probably not get past the portion on the Holocaust industry, though during the questions and answers I can speak to the more current events bearing on the so-called new anti-Semitism, which resurfaces about every 10 years, and also the pseudo-contrived strife in the Labour Party, which has a new element, it has to be said, that typically these new anti-Semitism hysterias are orchestrated by Israel supporters, but now it's been co-opted by the old guard in the Labour Party as a modus operandi to unseat the insurgents. And as in almost all of the phenomena in recent months, it's kind of eerie almost, the extent to which you see the resonances and the duplications in the case of the American insurgency represented by Bernie Sanders. And as some of you know, one of the tactics that we're trying to use against Bernie, the Democratic Party establishment, to try to slow down the Sanders juggernaut was to invoke not the fact that he was Jewish, because in the US it's a non-issue being Jewish, but the Democratic Party establishment tried to invoke the fact that he was an atheist. Yes, that was one of the strategies that was became known after the WikiLeaks. They were figuring out maybe, because the United States among industrialized countries tends to have a much higher percentage of religious people, tried to use that against him. So that was a new element in the new anti-Semitism, that it wasn't so much a Israel orchestrated, though obviously there were Israel-oriented people who wanted to see Corbyn unseated for obvious reasons, but it was mostly, I think, the old guard of the Labour Party, which tried to exploit the alleged anti-Semitism of Corbyn's followers, and also Corbyn himself, it was alleged, for strictly political reasons. But we can get to that later. Let me begin with the origins of the Holocaust industry, how it came to be. There's a famous remark by the Hungarian Marxist George Lukács. He was mandatory reading in my day his book History and Class Consciousness. I doubt he's read very much anymore. But he once said that it's important to see the present as history. And that remark always leaps to my mind when I think about or recall the Holocaust industry, because there's just a smattering of people in this room who reach back to my age cohort, but when I was growing up, the Holocaust, the Nazi Holocaust, it literally, and it may sound strange to people in this room who are obviously younger than myself, it literally did not exist in American consciousness. There was no Nazi Holocaust when I was growing up. I did come from a family where both my parents were survivors. They were the real survivors. Now everybody claims to be a survivor of Nazi Holocaust, or a second generation survivor, or a third generation survivor. You know, it's really weird, I have to say. If I ever went up to my mother and said I'm a second generation Holocaust survivor, she'd smack me in the face. She would. First of all, she did strongly believe in physical punishment. And probably, if I had said that, I would have deserved a couple of smacks in the face. But everybody now pretends to being a Holocaust survivor, or my parent, or my family. There were very few survivors of the Nazi Holocaust. It was exactly as we're told it was. It was a systematic, methodical, assembly line extermination. And given that it was systematic, methodical, assembly line, factory-like extermination, you wouldn't expect that there would be many survivors. That's what made it so systematic. Very few survived. And the serious estimates by historians as against apparatchiks, the serious estimates, about 100,000 Jews survived the Nazi Holocaust in 1945. A survivor back then meant somebody who survived the ghettos or the labor camps or the extermination camps. That's what a survivor was understood to mean. And in many cases, it was all three. So if I were to use my parents as illustrative examples, they were in the Warsaw Ghetto until April 1943. They were then, the survivors of the ghetto uprising were then deported to Majdanek concentration camp. There were about 20 to 30,000 people who survived the uprising. They were both then in Majdanek concentration camp, which was a death camp, and concentration camp, a work camp. And then my father was deported to Auschwitz, and as I understand it, he was in seven other camps because they kept moving the inmates as the Russian front advanced and the American front. And my mother was then in two slave labor camps. And that's what a survivor was understood to be. Ghetto, death camp, labor camp. And there were just a handful that survived, about 100,000. And you had to have been of a very special age cohort, because at the end, Nazis wanted people who can work. So if you were a child, you go to the gas chamber. If you were older, your work capacity was diminished, you went to the gas chamber. And so the age cohort of survivors would be roughly, again, my parents' age, in their early 20s. My father was born in 1919, my father was born in 1920. So you can do the arithmetic, about 25 at the end of the war. And so my parents were survivors. Everything I have to preface with, it will come as a surprise to you. But I'm going to do my best, I'll leave out that it will come as a surprise. I'm going to do my level best to be as accurate as I can, even though many of the things that I'll say will cause you to, an element of disbelief will come in. It was a great shame to be the son of Holocaust survivors back then, because the assumption was, if you survived the Nazi Holocaust, you must have done something dirty in order to survive. So I remember my mother, she would be very indignant when anyone would ask, and often it was asked in complete innocence, how did you survive? Because she understood it as a dig, that you must have done something dirty, or how did you survive? So the assumption was either you did something of which you ought to be ashamed, or the assumption was that we, meaning Jews, we went like Jews, we went like sheep to the ovens. That was the other side of the shame, that Jews did not fight back, they did not resist, we went like sheep to our deaths. So to be a Holocaust survivor, the child of a Holocaust survivor, it was a badge of not honor, it was a badge of shame back then. Never talked about. Also, it has to be said, and I'm going to digress on many of these points because, you know, now I'm older, I'm able to look back and see a bigger picture than when I was growing up. Jews were, at that point in time, in the 1950s and 60s, they were just then beginning to make it in American society. There had been, I wouldn't say terrible, but there were definitely, there were definite discriminations that Jews suffered in American society up until the end of World War II. Quotas at the better universities, quotas at the better law firms. There were all sorts of discriminations and disabilities. After World War II, for reasons which haven't yet been adequately, I think, explained in scholarship, all the discriminations and quotas against Jews, they disappeared. And now Jews were making it in American society. And they were making it in a very ambitious, confident way. Namely, the U.S. was a meritocracy. We, meaning Jews, we are the best. And nothing is going to stop us. And so Jews were not looking back at how we suffered. No. Jews were looking forward. We're going to conquer American society because we are the best. Very smart, very ambitious, very determined. As that song goes, the pop song, there's no stopping us now. And so they weren't interested in contemplating their past. They were looking to the future, a golden future. So when I was growing up, I moved with the fast crowd, intellectually really stupendous. I have to say, sometimes I go through the high school yearbook, I Google all my friends. At that point in time, it's changed a little. At that point in time, by far, the most prestigious profession was, of course, medicine. It's changed now since the 80s with Reagan, then business became actually a more desirable profession. But in my day, it was by a far margin, it was medicine. I would say 90%, no exaggeration, 90% of my friends ended up being medical doctors. And at the top of their field, several teach at Harvard Medical School. So they were very successful, very ambitious. My high school, Charles Schumer, the current senator from New York, who will probably be the Senate majority leader if Hillary wins the election, he was 3 years ahead of me. Bernie Sanders went to my high school. 5 Nobel laureates went to my high school. It's an incredible, and all Jewish, by the way. No, they're all Jewish, it's just a fact. It's an incredible achievement. So nobody bothered with the Nazi Holocaust. That was just something in the past, better forgotten than remembered. I could say with no fear of contradiction, if you were to take a polygraph and put it right now on my wrist, even though the folks I hung out with were as smart as they come, the best and the brightest, as it's called, and even though we lived in very political times, it was the 1960s, 70s, everybody cared about politics, everybody cared about history. Not one friend, not one parent of a friend, not one, ever asked a single question of me or my parents about what they went through. Not one. My father was in Auschwitz, my mother was in Majdanek. Every single family member of both sides was exterminated during the war. And here were the best, the brightest readers, tapped into the currents of the time, which were highly politicized. Nobody was interested in the Nazi Holocaust. Now, some of you may say, I'm limiting myself to personal anecdote. But then let's go outside my navel into the bigger picture. Up until the mid-60s, again, comes a surprise, there were only 2 scholarly studies on the Nazi Holocaust in the English language. For those of you who've read Hannah Arendt's Eichmann in Jerusalem, she wrote that about 64, 65. If you go look in her bibliography, she can only find in the English language 2 books. a book by Gerald Reitlinger called The Nazi SS, came out in the early 50s, and Raoul Hilberg's monumental study, The Destruction of the European Jews. Two. The estimate now is there are about 10,000 scholarly studies of the Nazi Holocaust. Just two back then. When Raoul Hilberg set out as his doctoral dissertation to write the destruction, what became The Destruction of the European Jews, his advisor at Columbia University was a quite famous sociologist, German Jewish, which I know Ben will know him. His name was Franz Neumann. And Neumann had written a classic study of German fascism called Behemoth, which is still read. And Hilberg goes to his advisor and he says, Neumann, he says, I want to write my doctoral dissertation. It wasn't called the Holocaust back then. I want to do my doctoral dissertation on the extermination of the Jews during World War II. And Neumann famously answered him, famously only because we know it from Hilberg's memoir. He said, quote, it's your funeral. You will never get a job in academia if you write a book on the extermination of the Jews. Some of you are, I can see from your faces, you are perplexed by that. Why would it be your funeral? Well, I'll get to that in a half second. Just to say before that at some point when I was writing the Holocaust industry and also later on when I was writing something else, I can't even remember what anymore, I did go through all of the standard Jewish publications of the time. Jews have a very literate, intellectual culture. They had their own publications, which included, by the way, most of the publications on the left were filled with Jewish writers, what were later called the New York Jewish intellectuals. But there was Commentary Magazine, Dissent Magazine, Partisan Review. They were all 95% they were Jewish. Left, right, and center was all Jewish. Not right. Left and center, it was all Jewish. And if you go through those publications, there's just no mention of the Nazi Holocaust. I read through them for the whole period from 47 to 67. It just never comes up. The most famous Jewish sociologist is a fellow Nathan Glazer, and he wrote a classic study in 1957 called American Judaism. And in it he said that the Nazi Holocaust, quote, had remarkably slight effects on the inner life of American Jewry. Remarkably slight effects. I would even go so far as to say it had no effect. It just didn't exist in the life of American Jews. The only exception is in grade school we read the Anne Frank diary, but we didn't read the Anne Frank diary as a Jewish story. We read it as a story of human suffering. The Jewish element, for better or for worse, the Jewish element was extirpated, pulled out by the root, and the only thing we understood it as a human tragedy, not as a Jewish tragedy. With the exception of Anne Frank's diary, it never came up to my recollection, and I should point out, I went to all Jewish schools, ethnic neighborhoods, so from grade school till college, I didn't even know a non-Jew. Yeah, it's just a fact. Never. There was Virginia DiMario and Robert Kinney. That was two people in 12 years. Otherwise, it was all Jewish, but it never came up. Now, I noticed, as I said a moment ago, some of you look perplexed when I said, when I quoted Hilbert being told by Franz Neumann, it's your funeral. Well, why was it your funeral? The answer was very straightforward. It was political. After World War II, the United States' main ally in Europe was West Germany, the Federal Republic. And the West German government after World War II, for perfectly obvious reasons, communists fled to the east, the DDR. The old elites stayed in the west. And so the German government consisted, aside from Adenauer at the top, it consisted mostly of former Nazi bureaucrats. You can't create a government, a new government bureaucracy overnight. It's not possible. It's the same reason why, on a tangent, and you'll forgive me the tangents, it's the same reason why if Trump gets elected or if Sanders had gotten elected, the governments wouldn't have looked very different. Because there's a huge bureaucracy that has to be staffed. And where are you going to get the people? You have to draw on the old elites who are knowledgeable. You know, Sanders had no fault, I'm saying, but his main campaign manager sold comic books. Well, that's a fact. Well, it would be hard to put him in charge of the Pentagon. It's true. And the same, so to speak, dilemma, to the extent that it was a dilemma, and that's a separate issue, the same dilemma faced the Germans after World War II. You could only draw on the old elites. So the German government below Adenauer was overwhelmingly former Nazis. And the Soviet Union capitalized on that fact and capitalized on the anti-Nazi sentiment by pointing out that this, what they called back then the revanchist, they want revenge, the revanchist German regime is filled with communists. So,
Nazis.
So, to make a long story short, the Nazis, one of the Nazis' biggest crimes was the Nazi Holocaust. If you brought up the Holocaust, you were seen as serving communist Soviet ends. Because it was the communists and the Soviet Union who kept hammering away at these were the people who exterminated the Jews. That's America's ally, the ones who exterminated the Jews. So if you talked about the Nazi Holocaust, you were seen as serving Soviet communist propaganda. And in fact, it is true to say that a lot of the Jews who did bring it up were left-wing communist Jews. That's just a fact. So Jews who were now wanting to make it in the United States, the last thing they wanted to be seen as was aiding and abetting Soviet communist propaganda against the new German government. Jews in quiet ways, would express their displeasure of the West German government. Who here remembers, there's just a handful of older people here, who remembers the one way that they expressed it?
German rearmament.
What? I would not say that, because that was too political. The way they did it quietly is they would refuse to buy a German product like the Volkswagen. No, my parents felt very strongly about that. Don't buy the Volkswagen.
They hated Wagner.
What?
They hated Wagner.
They didn't think that Jews should play him. They did not think that you know, like my mother would say, there's so much music.
Okay.
Why does, what's his name? you know, the...
Baron Boy?
Yeah, why does Baron Boy have to choose Wagner? Yes, but it was more, you know, I'm talking about working class Jews, the way they expressed it in a quiet way, was the Volkswagen, the boycott of the Volkswagen. But otherwise, you don't want to appear to be bringing up the Holocaust, because that made you a communist. And in fact, it was true. If you did bring it up, you were a communist. There were some commemorations of the Nazi Holocaust. They were all communist-inspired or within the periphery of the Communist Party, because we used to attend them, and it was true, they were communist-inspired. And the Jews also had the fear of being tainted as a communist because it was the McCarthy era. So it was not just, we want to make it in the United States so we don't want to seem communist. It's also, it's a serious issue. It was the McCarthy era. I remember my father told a story when he came to the United States. My parents loved the Soviet Union. They loved Stalin to the last day of their lives. If you said anything against Stalin, it shows that you are an opportunist. That's how they felt. And actually, I respected them for that. No, I did. Because they had gratitude. The Soviet Union defeated the Nazis. That's all they cared about. They saw the world through one lens, the Nazi Holocaust, and they felt a sense of gratitude. If it weren't for the Soviet Union, they wouldn't be here, I wouldn't be here. That's just a fact. But when my father came over, one of the conditions for entering the United States was you had to sign a statement saying, in case of war, you'll fight the Soviet Union. And my father was very torn. He loved the Soviet Union. In 1953, when the Rosenbergs, Ethel and Julius Rosenberg, were accused of being atomic spies and they were eventually executed, my parents wanted to sign a petition in defense of the Rosenbergs, but they were afraid. To be Jewish at that time meant to be, was seen to mean you were tainted with being on the left. So, if you want to make it American society in the McCarthy era, that's not what you want to do. That's not what you want to appear to be on the left. And so Jews, for practical political reasons, I mean, there was, as I said, a cultural dimension. Jews were looking forward then, they weren't looking back. You don't need the pressing news about Jews being exterminated because we're about to take over the country. And in fact, they did. You know, it's true, Jews were incredibly successful. Jews are now, by far, it's not even close, the most successful ethno-religious, the wealthiest ethno-religious group in the United States. And if you look at the entire ruling establishment, it's not for conspiracy theories, it's about the reality of Jewish success. Chelsea Clinton, the Clinton's daughter, married a Jew, Mark Mizvinsky. Trump's daughter, Donald Trump's daughter, married an Orthodox Jew. Both ruling families, both contending families for the presidency, both of them are now, if I can use the expression without the CST getting in my case, so I have to emphasize I'm using this for literary effect, I'm not making a political statement, both families have been infiltrated by Jews. Part of the international Jewish conspiracy. Yeah, the success has been phenomenal. And the odd thing is, when Chelsea Clinton marries a Jew and when Ivanka Trump marries a Jew, it's seen as boosting their social status. So, they were forward-looking, not backward-looking. And we have to say, forward-looking with a certain amount of insight. They were right. Work hard, ambitious beyond belief, you can make it. And they made it. And also, I'm not afraid to say, they were very smart. Where the smarts came from, don't ask me. I'm not going to go into the genetics. That was Chomsky's lecture. But very smart. Not as smart as they once were. Now, I think Jews are the new Jews, I think it's quite clear, are in the United American society. They're the Chinese. And they're displacing Jews in all the competitions. They're displacing. No, that's a factual matter. If you look at all the math competitions and all the standard measures of academic success, Jews are far ahead, Chinese are far outstripping Jews now. Well, the obvious question then is, what changed? How did this Holocaust industry come into play? If I'm accurate in saying it was next to near absent in American Jewish life. And the answer is, it's another case of having to understand the present as history. The answer is, oddly enough, Israel. Now, I said to you a moment ago, at some length and perhaps the point of tedium, that the Nazi Holocaust didn't play a significant role in American life. Now, again, surprising, neither did Israel. From Israel's founding in 1947 until 1967, Israel didn't figure at all in American Jewish life, except as an object of charity. Occasionally you'd give money to build a tree, you know, grow a tree in Israel, but that was really about it. The same fellow Nathan Glazer, who said the Holocaust had a remarkably slight effect on the inner life of American Jewry, he also said, so did, he said, strangely enough, he said, so did Israel. It had almost no effect on American Jewish life. And the answer was pretty obvious. Why? Because Jews have historically been burdened with what's called the charge of dual loyalty. This notion that Jews are loyal to their state, but they're also loyal to this entity called International World Jewry. So there was this notion of tugging in the hearts of all Jews was a dual loyalty. And truth be told, the assumption was if push came to shove, or so-called the moment of truth, that Jews would align themselves to their people before they would align themselves with the country where they exercised citizenship. Now, after 1947, with the creation of the State of Israel, the notion of dual loyalty was no longer a speculative one. It was a factual reality. Because whereas this notion of world Jewry or an international Jewish conspiracy, even though that was one that was speculative speculative, after 1947, there is a state created which claims to be the representative of the Jewish people. There is now a material, institutional embodiment of this notion of the Jewish people. It's called Israel. And so American Jews now face the very real problem that dual loyalty had become a reality. Who are you loyal to? The state to which you're a citizen, namely the United States in the case of American Jewry, or this state which claims to represent you, namely the State of Israel. Well, for obvious reasons, which I've already delineated at perhaps too much length, of course American Jews are loyal to the U.S. because they're making it in American society. Israel is this kind of strange backwater in the Middle East. Very poor, very simple. Yes, it's true, it embodies an ethos, or appears to embody an ethos, which many Jews just a couple of decades earlier strongly identified with, the kibbutzim, an egalitarian institution, communize the family, which I would have preferred to Punta Cana, and austere. The leaders of the labor movement in Israel, I don't want to offend anyone, but they were basically, they modeled themselves as Bolsheviks. Ben-Gurion, all the rest, they saw themselves as Jewish Bolsheviks. So, there was an appeal of Israel to their youthful sensibility. The Jews in the 1930s, the proletarianized masses, Communist Party, labor unions, all of which Jews were highly involved in. But now we're after World War II. Jews are becoming suburbanized. They're becoming professionals. They don't want to go back to that. They're now moving forward. And so Jews had no interest in Israel in a double sense. Interest meaning they had no material interest in talking about Israel because it conjures up the bogey of dual loyalty. And they want to make it. They're determined to make it in American society. And also they had no interest in the sense that it was something from their past. It was their youthful flirtation with radical politics. But the Depression is over. They're no longer living in Lower East Side tenements. They are, as the song goes, they are moving on up. And I grew up with those folks. There was no leftism left. This is a very ambitious lower middle class. So Israel didn't figure in American Jewish life. Elie Wiesel, the preposterous mountebank who recently passed away, he was asked just before the 1967 war. American Jews seemed to be becoming very secular, losing connection with their Jewish identity in formal ways. He was asked, how can you reach American Jewish youth? And he replied, the Jewishness of Jewish youth can still be reached, but not through Israel. Perhaps through the problems of Jews in Russia, perhaps through questions about the Holocaust, but not through Israel. Israel was a dead letter for American Jews. I don't recall a single conversation about Israel. I mean, we talked about the civil rights movement, for sure. That was a prominent, that was salient on the radar. We talked about the war in Vietnam, for sure. But Israel never came up. It's funny because Charles Schumer, the senator from New York, he's this fanatic so-called pro-Israel, really, it's just campaign contributions. I didn't know him, but I knew his sister reasonably well. Not well, very well, but The sister was a very impressive character, Fran Schumer, probably in my life, smartest young woman I ever met. Really a very impressive show. Israel was never even on the radar. We were America, the most powerful country on earth. And we were soon going to be controlling America. And Charles Schumer soon will be. He'll be the Senate. He'll be the Senate majority leader. Who wants to talk about Israel somewhere in the middle of a desert? It's just, well, then the question becomes, what happened? And how did these two phenomena, which I have expatiated on, namely the Holocaust and the Israel, how do they intersect? And I think the key turning point is the June 1967 war. Because after the June 1967 war, as one of the leading spokespersons in Jewish intellectual life, Norman Podhoretz, put it, he said, after the 67 war, Israel became the religion of American Jews. And the question is, why? What happened? And how is that connected with the Nazi Holocaust? And the answer, as I see it, is the following. In 1967, Israel inflicts a major historical defeat on one of the U.S.'s major antagonists or adversaries on the world scene. The Middle East contains the most precious resource in the industrialized world, namely the oil. And the U.S. was controlling the region, except for after World War II, beginning, you know, in the interwar period, but after World War II, the phenomenon of what came to be called radical Arab nationalism. And radical Arab nationalism basically meant this weird idea that had seized the distorted imagination of the Arab people that the resources beneath their feet belonged to them. It was obviously some sort of mass hysteria, a pandemic lunacy in the Arab world. And the figure who embodied, I know, he's going to give me the thing. Oh, great, I still have 2 hours. Thank you, comrade. And the person who embodied the phenomenon of radical Arab nationalism was, of course, you're nodding your head, Gamal Abdel Nasser of Egypt. He was the galvanizing force of what was called radical Arab nationalism, and he was seen. Originally, the U.S. tried to buy him off, promising to finance the Aswan Dam and made all sorts of overtures to Nasser. Nasser proved not amenable to those overtures to the extent that they constrained his ability to foment radical insurgencies elsewhere in the Arab Muslim world. His main antagonist back then was the Saudi regime, but everywhere he was sort of playing the kind of role that Castro played in the 1960s, but with much more serious consequences, because there was no resource of the magnitude of oil at stake in Latin America. Obviously, there were places like Venezuela, but it, you know, the Middle East was a different kettle of fish. And so Nasser was unwilling to tie his hands behind his back when it came to trying to spread the notion of pan-Arabism, pan-Nasserism, and the United States eventually gave up any hope by the time of the Kennedy administration in weaning Nasser away from his quote-unquote radical ideas. And then the hope was, of course, to get rid of him. In 1956, as most of you know in this room, being of British persuasion, in 1956, the French, the British, and Israel tried to dispose of Nasser. The British, allegedly because he nationalized the Suez Canal, but really because he was fomenting discord in the British turf in the Middle East. The French had a different reason. The French were convinced at the time that the insurgency in Algeria was being orchestrated and coordinated in Egypt. It wasn't true, but that's what the French believed. And the Israelis, well, because Israelis hate Arabs, so. Get rid of Nasser and we can have our slaves back. So the United States opposed what was called back then the tripartite invasion of Egypt. However, Eisenhower, who was the president then, and Secretary of State Dulles, they opposed it only because of the timing. They said that Nasser is too popular now. Now is not the time to get rid of him. Hold back. We'll knock him off later. And as it came to pass, it wasn't the US or the British or the French that knocked off Nasser. It was the Israelis. In 1967, through a concatenation of events, which I think are very poorly understood till this day, I think the case for Egypt was infinitely stronger than Israel's in 1967. The two basic facts about 1967, for those who care about facts, as against YouTubes, the two basic facts about 1967 are, number one, Nasser had no intention to attack, and number two, it was understood by everyone across the board that if he attacked, and even if he attacked in concert with the other neighboring Arab states, to quote Lyndon Baines Johnson at the time, who was our president, he checked with all the US intelligence agencies, about six of them, and they all came back with the same conclusion. The conclusion was, as Johnson told the Israeli representative when he came to the United States, according to all our data, even if Egypt attacks, which it's not going to, and even if it attacks in concert with the other Arab countries, and now I'm quoting Johnson, you will whip the hell out of them. And in fact, that's exactly what happened. Our intelligence agencies functioned up to par, and the thing was over in 6 days. Actually, the thing was over in about 5 minutes. That's a fact. Once Israel launched the preemptive strike and knocked out the Egyptian Air Force, there was nothing left. The only reason it lasted longer is because Israel wanted to take more territory. So it eventually took the West Bank, it took Gaza took right away, took the West Bank, and then it took the Golan Heights. If it were simply a matter of defeating Nasser, it would have been over, it was over in the blink of an eye. The entire Egyptian Air Force was knocked out on the ground. There was nothing left to defend their troops.
So,
Israel had done the deed. It had accomplished, achieved a very significant victory. It had terminated the threat posed for more than a decade, from 1952 to 67, a 15-year threat posed by radical Arab nationalism. After 67, it was over. As a threat to the region, radical Arab nationalism was finished, and then a period elapsed between 67, obviously, and 79, when it was displaced or replaced by radical Islamic fundamentalism. So radical Arab nationalism, which was very secular in its orientation, the main victims of the Nasser regime was the Muslim Brotherhood, who were in very large numbers consigned to Nasser's torture chambers. It was over. And now Israel became, as the language of the times called it, Israel became the U.S.'s strategic ally in the Middle East. And that had many consequences. American Jewry no longer had to fear identifying with Israel, because Israel was no longer a kind of dual loyalty. Israel now connoted super loyalty to the United States, because Israel had defeated the U.S.'s principal antagonist in the Middle East. Israel was now on the front lines fighting the Soviet and Arab hordes threatening Western civilization. So now, if you were Jewish, you were proud to identify with Israel, because Israel was fighting American wars. And not only that, Israel was winning. Remember, this is during the Vietnam War, and the United States is being, quote unquote, humiliated by these diminutive Vietnamese who were humbling the most powerful army in the world. And then along comes Israel with this general, this kind of, hard to describe him. If any of you have the chance and the interest, it's very worthwhile to read Isaac Deutscher's last interview in New Left Review on Israel. Deutscher was a very smart guy. Don't ever doubt that. Deutscher was extremely sharp political eye. And he has a description there of Moshe Dayan. While I'm talking, for any of you who have your little devices, I think they're called computers or something, Google Deutscher New Left Review 1968. And then maybe you can read out to us how he describes Moshe Dayan, who was a very a sinister but very insightful picture. But this was the new Israel. Moshe Dayan was, because I don't know, I may be using names that you don't even know, Moshe Dayan was credited with the victory in 1967. He was appointed defense minister at the last minute. Moshe Dayan was now a Jew, a soldier, a Jew, a general, a Jew, the most revered general now in the Western world. very strange, because the image of Jews was, one, going like sheep to slaughter, and two, some version of Woody Allen. Yes, that was true, that's what we were. We were bookish, nerdy, horn-rimmed glasses, losers, you know, in the great battle for American masculinity, losers. And then come along Moshe Dayan with the pirate patch and seducing all these women. He was known for having a, you know, his pleasures. It was like, for a Jew, it's the greatest thing since, you know, sliced bread. And there was no longer a conflict of interest. He was fighting America's battles. He was being called in as an advisor how to defeat the Vietnamese, yes. Yes, it was, for Jews, it was a heroic period, and the heroism was stamped with the Israeli brand. So now, it was not only safe to be pro-Israel, it was actually a bonus to be pro-Israel if you're Jewish. And it was a kind of irony. It's an irony which I don't think is much appreciated. Zionism began as an idea. As an idea, it begins with the notion that Jews could never assimilate to Western European societies. The Jews would never be accepted. At the bottom, there was a kind of physical, if you read people like Jabotinsky, there was a physical repulsion that Gentiles felt for Jews, and they would never be accepted. And that's why we need to found our own state. And then the irony was, the product of Zionism was Israel. And Israel, after 67, it facilitated the American Jewish assimilation to our society. We now became real Americans because we, meaning Jews, were soldiers, we were fighters, we were defending American interests. So ironically, Zionism begins, its central premise is the impossibility of Jews assimilating to Western society. And the irony was, Zionism in the form of Israel, it not only was not impossible, it facilitated the American Jewish assimilation. Because Jews did carry the burden of being kind of weaklings. For those of you who know the image of Kafka, Kafka is an early, if you physically, he's an early version of Woody Allen. He is. And now we have Moshe Dayan, the IDF, the fighters, which is the way Israelis like to describe themselves, the fighters. Some of you may know that when the Jewish survivors of Nazi Holocaust went over to Israel after the war, and they settled on the kibbutzim, you know what the nickname of them was? What?
Sapon.
Because the claim was, it's not correct, but the claim was that the Nazis made the fat from soap from the Jewish corpses. So the two claims, they were both factually incorrect, that the Nazis made the lampshades, Ilse Koch was, and the soap from Jews, the lampshades from the skin, the soap from the Jewish fat. But that was, it was widely believed at the time. And so the Israelis called the Jewish survivors soap, you know, to humiliate and degrade them. You return, and we're fighters. You allowed yourself to become so. We're fighters. That's how the Israelis, even in the Holocaust Remembrance Day, they don't call it Holocaust Remembrance. They call it Holocaust Resistance and Remembrance. The Jewish fighters. One of the sins of Raoul Hilberg, why the Israeli establishment hated him, he said, what was true? He said, there was no resistance. You're making the whole thing up. The Warsaw Ghetto, there was an element of heroism. But resistance, come on. The Soviet Red Army could barely defeat the Germans. And you're telling me Jews in the ghetto, who had been in the ghetto, had been starved for years, they're going to defeat the German army? But it was all a myth created by the Israelis, the resistance, the fighters. There was a period when the Israelis were fighters. Now, in my opinion, and I don't say it loosely, I'm saying it on camera, they're the most cowardly army on earth. The most cowardly army on God's earth. There's nothing like the Israeli army. There's no fighting. Who do they fight? When they were in Lebanon in 2006, they were terrified of going hand-to-hand combat with a party of God, with the Hezbollah. I met the Hezbollah fighters. The Israelis were right to be terrified. No, really. Some of these guys were like Mr. T, 6'5", both in height and weight, in the waistline. You could see the Israeli rockets just bounce off them. And they couldn't wait to fight the Israeli army, you can imagine. Because they were under the occupation from 78 to 1990. So, from, excuse me, 78 to 2000. They couldn't wait to fight the Israeli army. The Israelis, they tangle with Gaza. Oh, very heroic.
Yeah,
very courageous, yeah. Fighting Gaza. Yeah. But that's the image they cultivated. Jews capitalized on that image. And now, as he writes me a note saying I have...
And for please, comrade, that's all
there. Please, comrade, okay. If you say please, it's very un-Stalinist of you, but I'll... Comrade, 5 minutes. You didn't see Ninotchka, you could see it. And that brings us to the end of our topic, where did the Holocaust come in? And, well, two things happened in 1967. Israel achieved what appeared to be a huge military victory, but it also now entered into an occupation. And the international community was not prepared to sanction the occupation. There was at the time, and I've read the record very closely, there was in the United Nations a big debate about how to resolve this conflict in the Middle East. As you know, it's the longest standing conflict in the UN. The UN played the principal role in the first stage, which was the partition resolution and the eventual creation of the State of Israel. And now we were in round two, after the 67 war. And the international community, as embodied in the UN, was determined to resolve the conflict. It resulted in a major debate in the UN, actually, I would say, an outstanding debate. It was a quality debate. And there were two basic positions during the debate. There was the Latin American bloc, and there was the Afro-Asian bloc. The Latin American bloc said that, well, let me start with the Afro-Asian bloc. The Afro-Asian bloc which was very pro-Soviet. It said it's inadmissible to acquire territory by war. Israel acquired the West Bank, Gaza, East Jerusalem, the Golan Heights, and the Sinai Peninsula. All those territories were conquered during the 67 war. They were conquered in the course of a war. Israel has to withdraw. International law does not sanction the acquisition of territory by war. So if you look at UN Resolution 242, which most of you are familiar with, it starts off by saying, given the inadmissibility of the acquisition of territory by war. So the position of the Afro-Asian bloc, and behind it the Soviet Union, their position was there has to be a unilateral, unconditional Israeli withdrawal from the occupied territories in accordance with the principle of inadmissibility of acquisition of territory by war. The Latin American bloc, and standing behind it, though not dictating, but standing behind it, was the US position, namely, there had to be a quid pro quo. Israel, yes, it has to withdraw, the US agreed to that, but the withdrawal has to be conditional on the Arab states accepting Israel's existence as a state. Namely, Israel was a member state of the United Nations. Under Article 2 of the UN Charter, states are entitled to live in peace with their neighbors, and therefore, Israel can no longer be the object of a belligerency. The Arab states, which had claimed they were at war with Israel from right after its founding, they had to renounce the state of belligerency with Israel. And that came to be encapsulated in the formula of land for peace. As it happened, the Latin American position won out at the UN, and it didn't mean Israel could retain the territories it acquired, but it did mean that the acquisition was conditional on the renunciation of belligerency by the Arab states. To make a long story short, Israel had no intention of withdrawing. It didn't care about whether the Arab states recognized it or not. You could recognize Israel till the end of time. We're not leaving. We want those territories, and we're keeping those territories, just like every other country in the world acquired its borders in the course of a war or wars. We're going to have our borders as a result of the wars we won. Well, as you can imagine, in many ways the international community felt as if it had been duped, because it had deferred to the Israeli demand that it not have to withdraw until and unless the Arab states recognized its right as a state. But then it became perfectly clear that they weren't going to withdraw even if and when the Arab states recognized it. And so now, Israel, which had accumulated a huge amount of goodwill from the international community, as we were discussing earlier, I was talking to Ben and some other fellows in this room, I don't recall who. The Israelis were extremely lucky in the amount of support they had in the international community. The Cold War had already begun in 1947, but by one of those great flukes of history from which the Zionist movement benefited, both the Soviet Union and the US, even though at this time they were at loggerheads over everything, both of them voted to recognize the creation of a Jewish state. Both of them voted for the partition resolution. As a matter of fact, by far, as the older people in this room will remember, by far the most eloquent speech given at the UN on Israel's founding in 47 was Foreign Minister Molotov. For those of you who are interested in the arcana of this conflict, it's worth reading that speech. He talks about the suffering of the Jewish people and how they deserve a state now. And so by a fluke, both the Soviet Union and the US, right in the midst of the Cold War, they ended up on the same side. It's probably the only issue in which they were on the same side in the whole Cold War, was over Israel's creation. But now, Israel was facing a problem. It was alienating the international community. And it then started to invoke the Nazi Holocaust, in particular, one claim which became the kind of mantra of the Nazi Holocaust. The mantra was that the Nazi Holocaust was unique, or what in the scholarly literature, it wasn't really scholarly, I shouldn't put that, in the popular literature, came to be called the uniqueness doctrine. And the uniqueness doctrine basically said that never before in the history of humanity has a crime been committed of the magnitude and of the quality of the Nazi Holocaust. Both quantitatively and qualitatively, the Nazi Holocaust belonged to a category all its own. And the uniqueness doctrine served a very specific, calculated political purpose. The purpose was, if nobody in the history of humanity suffered the way Jews suffered, then ordinary standards of right and wrong shouldn't be applied to them, because ordinary standards of right and wrong are designed for ordinary circumstances and ordinary situations. But the Jewish situation and circumstance is not ordinary. It's abnormal, not ordinary, and therefore you can't hold us, meaning Jews in general, and you can't hold us in particular, meaning Israelis, you can't hold us to these ordinary standards. So whenever Israel was, and it was quite frequently given to the point of every minute of every day, to committing another atrocity, to committing another gross violation of international law, to committing another crime, war crime or crime against humanity, the standard refrain became, well, remember the Holocaust. Yeah. What about the Holocaust? Yeah. And so the Nazi Holocaust became a kind of, not a kind of, it became an ideological weapon to delegitimize criticism of Israel, because Israel shouldn't be held to the same standard. And then there was a second aspect, and that's where I'm going to leave it. The second aspect of it was that the Nazi Holocaust was the climax, the culmination of a millennial, irrational, Gentile hatred of Jews. The Nazi Holocaust was the culmination, the climax of this millennial, irrational hatred of Jews, which meant that all anti-Semitism was irrational. The Holocaust was the culmination of millennial, irrational Gentile hatred of Jews. The Nazi Holocaust was the culmination of anti-Semitism. So, if the Holocaust was irrational, anti-Semitism must be irrational. If anti-Semitism means dislike of Jews, that must mean all dislike of Jews, which is anti-Semitism, must also be irrational. Which means anyone who criticized Israel must be criticizing it for irrational reasons. And therefore, it has nothing to do with Jews. It's their hatred of us. That's what's causing this criticism of Israel. Because if they don't like us, it must be because of anti-Semitism. And if it's anti-Semitism, it's irrational. And therefore, all of the criticism of Israel has nothing to do with our actions. It's their problem, not ours. They hate us. They have always hated us. And that's the real cause of this criticism of Israel. And all of you are familiar with it. It's the claim that lurking behind any and all criticism of Israel, lurking behind, sometimes in subtle ways, sometimes in blatant ways, but it's all, at the end of the day, motivated by anti-Semitism. And so it became a very convenient explanation, the Nazi Holocaust and the rationale behind it, this notion of the Nazi Holocaust being the culmination of irrational, millennial, Gentile hatred of Jews, it then became a very convenient excuse for Israeli conduct, namely, it's not that we're doing anything wrong, it's that they claim we're doing things wrong because they hate Jews. The most vivid elucidation of that idea was quite popular in the 1990s with this book, which has since passed into oblivion, deservedly so, called Hitler's Willing Executioners by a semi-maniac, Daniel Jonah Goldhagen. And the main thesis of the book was that all the Germans wanted to exterminate the Jews. Hitler came along, gave them the green light, and then they proceeded to do so. But Germans, if you understood the mentality of the person who wrote it, and also the spirit of the times, the Zeitgeist, Germans were just a stand-in in Goldhagen's book for Gentiles. It wasn't really about Germans, it was about all Gentiles lurking in their hearts is this desire to exterminate the Jews. And so the Nazi Holocaust became an ideological weapon used by Israel to delegitimize criticism of it, but with one major change, and that's where I'll leave it. Israel always had a Holocaust industry. It's a little cottage industry, Yad Vashem, their Holocaust museum. It never had much impact, as I said, there was barely anything written about it. But now, the huge resources and power of American Jewry, which is very substantial in key sectors involved in public opinion, publishing, journals, Hollywood. Those where Jews exercised a lot of power, they now became the agency for promoting this Holocaust mania. And from a little, very tiny cottage industry in Israel, it then exploded into a real global phenomenon, such that I'm not much of a, I don't go to movies, I don't do anything. Went on vacation at a horrible time, in case you don't know. But sometimes my friend, my sister-in-law, and then another friend got me onto Netflix, and I'm going through the movies. Every third movie is in a Nazi Holocaust. Comedies, Holocaust. Action, Holocaust. Classics, Holocaust. Holocaust, Holocaust, Holocaust. Crazy. That's it. Very pro-Zionist,
yes.
In part for the reasons that were just mentioned, partly is because they were all socialists, they were part of the same international, and they identified ideologically. But part of it was, if you read people like Richard Crossman, who was a prominent member of the British Labour Party at the time, and he was in one of the UN missions to Palestine, and he has a book, Palestine Diary, it's a sophisticated piece of work, but he talks about the Jews are very resourceful. They did impress the foreign delegations, particularly the left-wing delegations, like the British Labour Party. They did impress them with their austerity. Seemed like they were turning the desert into a, you know, blooming whatever. And there was a kind of prejudice in favor of the Jewish resourcefulness and the appearance of being quote unquote just like us as against the Arabs. On the question of Bergen-Belsen, that's correct. Bergen-Belsen was definitely not one of the. It wasn't the death camp. But if some of you may know, you'll know then. The first classic biography of Hitler was the one by Joachim Fest.
Joachim Fest.
Yeah. And it's called Hitler. And I read it very late in life. And since it has a large book, it's probably around 800 pages. And it's very smart. Fest had this really very shrewd insight into character. More a psychobiography. But what struck me was, when you look back at it, it's almost funny. It's 800 pages, about. It had one paragraph in the Nazi Holocaust. One paragraph. I don't need a chapter. One paragraph. That's how the history was written back then. There were a number of issues that were raised, and as I look down the list, I'll just say a couple of comments about most of the issues and then focus on what I think is a serious moral issue, it's a serious political issue, and out of deference to my late parents, I would not want to end this session or any session conveying the idea that in any way I trivialize or diminish the magnitude of the suffering they endured, and by extension, the magnitude of the suffering that was visited on Jews during World War II. So for the last several minutes, I'll focus on that question. Members of the audience speculated on the possible and reasons why people didn't talk about it in my generation. And among the speculations were, number one, that Jews didn't exercise the kind of cultural power that they do today. And number two, the possibility that having been traumatized, they felt silent. As a factual matter, I would say neither of those are credible explanations. First of all, as a book famously put it, the Jews who made Hollywood, of the six major studios in Hollywood, five of them were owned by Jews. Jews did make Hollywood, and they exercised in the person of the owners, they exercised that kind of cultural power in the 1950s and 60s. They had the discretion and the option of making films on the subject or not. It's kind of an irony. I mean, there were some excellent films made. I should point out The Judgment at Nuremberg, which was made, I think, in 1961. It's about a reenacted trial of the German industrialists done by a Hollywood left-wing director. It's very expertly done and very revealing, surprising it made it through the vetting process of Hollywood. There were a couple of films like that. I found the best film personally to be one that nobody has seen, except maybe people in this room, Costa Gavras's The Music Box. Anyone see The Music Box? See, it's funny. It's well worth watching. Costa Gavras, as most of you know, was the Greek filmmaker who did Z and other left-wing. He did the one on Chile. Its title just slipped my mind. What was the one on Chile? What? No, Zed was on the Greek coup. The one on Chile, nobody knows? He also did one on, the Nazi Holocaust, and there was a Hungarian actor. I don't want to tell you the plot, I don't want to give it away. Very well done. Also, as a curiosity, the best memoirs of the Nazi Holocaust, they were not written during the heyday of the Holocaust industry. When it became a business, the quality, as you can imagine, drastically declined. The best memoirs were written right after the war. Primo Levi's, what came to be called Survival at Auschwitz, it was originally called This Be Man, and he wrote it in 1950. So this notion that they were traumatized, didn't want to talk about it. No, they talked about it. It was ignored. The best memoir, in my opinion, was actually not written by a Jew. It was written by an Australian non-Jew, Ella Lingens-Reiner. L-I-N-G-E-N-S, Lingens-Reiner, R-E-I-N-E-R. It's called Prisoners of Fear. Ella Lingens-Reiner was an Austrian non-Jew. She ended up in Auschwitz because she had done some small things. She didn't inflate her role. She took in a Jew who was fleeing the Nazis. She got caught, ended up in Auschwitz, and she was a medical doctor by training. And so she worked, and this is before the name became iconic, she worked side by side with Mengele. It's a kind of amazing story because at one point she left a child behind, a newly born child. She's in Auschwitz. And at one point she's faced with the dilemma, if she released some information, I can't remember now what it was, she would be freed. And she's carrying the guilt of her child. Her child is not there. And reuniting with her child. And what should she do? And it's a real memoir, it's not Hollywood, it's real. She decides not to reveal the information. One of the things that I found, the book is, it's a little memoir. What was the famous British publishing house, Victor Glantz? Yeah, he published it back then. But one of the things that really struck me, but there are many things, she talked about the fact that she worked with Mengele, and once some issue, an ideological issue came up, and she turned to him, and he said, with contempt and ridicule, he said, "You believe that stuff about Nazi ideology?" And she said, I was shocked. And this is her words, remember, it's 1950. She's writing it. She said, he was just an opportunist. He didn't believe any of the ideology. Now we have this image of Mengele as being this, you know, super Nazi fanatic, and she's working side by side, and she said, he didn't believe any of it. He was just an opportunist. That one is very worth watching. My mother's favorite, and it goes back to some things that were mentioned during the questions and answers. It was Seven Beauties. Lena Wertmüller's Seven Beauties. Has anybody seen it? Very disappointing. I'm afraid to ask, does anyone know who Lena Wertmüller is? Well, I'm giving away my age, but you're also giving away your ignorance. Well, I can't even discuss it, but I watched the film. I remember my mother said she liked it a lot. She was the film. I didn't understand why. There was a guy put in the concentration camp, and at the end, he has a guard, a female guard, and she wants him to do something degrading, sexually degrading for her. And they don't show him actually committing the act. But the scene then comes to liberation. The war is over, and you see him, and he wants to celebrate, but you could see he can't celebrate because he did something for which he feels eternally shamed. And there were some issues raised about survivors' guilt. One person raised it. And I once did finally summon up the courage to ask my mother. I remember she was at the ironing board, and I was in the bedroom, and I said, well, did you do anything that you were ashamed of? And she was very emphatic. She said, no. She said that at one point she was offered the position of being a blockhead. The camps were divided into blocks, and each block had a Jew who was in charge, and so they were being a blockhead. And she turned it down. It was funny because when the book was translated into Arabic, the person who was a very good translator, but he misunderstood it as my mother said she wouldn't be a blockhead. You understand? Yeah. But on the other hand, to get the picture full, and to get a full picture, you have to see all sides, as we'll discuss tomorrow for those of you who want to hear about Mill, John Stuart Mill. She did say the same thing as Primo Levi. She said the best people did not survive. I have to be honest about that. The best did not survive because they were too fragile, too refined, too cultured to engage in that war of survival, which was being in a camp. You have a vat of soup. The soup consists 95% of water, and then there are a few vegetables thrown in. There's a long line. If you don't elbow and push to the front, you're not going to get the vegetable, and you're not going to survive. And so, if you were too cultured, too refined, or as my mother would say, too delicate, you couldn't survive. It was just a fact. So you have to see, you know, my mother gave her answer, she did nothing to be ashamed of. I know, by the way, I knew her well enough that the way she said it emphatically, I knew it was true. But I also understood that she had to engage in that war of survival. Otherwise, she couldn't have survived. You can take the high road, but the high road was a beeline for the ovens. That's just a fact. The last question is, how do you remember? Speaking with absolute candor, the moment I see a New York Times article on the Holocaust, I laugh and I move on. I haven't read anything on the subject. I can't stand it. It just fills me with disgust because it's just so obviously manipulative. And the case of the New York Times, its reader base is Upper East Side Jews who love to talk about themselves and can't stand, you know, there is their navel, and that's it. There's nothing past the navel. All they want to do is wallow in their pretended suffering, as if anyone on the Upper West East Side suffers. So I've developed a real aversion to any reference to it, and sometimes, as you can see, to the point of irreverence. But having said that, there just shouldn't be, I can understand it, but we shouldn't get involved in any kind of discussion which attempts to try to diminish the magnitude of the suffering that was endured. I went a couple of years ago to Iran. I was taken on tour by the Ahmadinejadites, who saw me as a vital resource in the struggle that was then going on with the reform movement. And they invited me strictly because they were convinced that I was a Holocaust denier, mostly because they read the Persian version of my book, which was slightly redacted, let's put it that way, as only an Ahmadinejadite would know. So I went to several of the towns for town meetings, and there would be 300 people gathered, and all they wanted to talk about was the Holocaust. I was coming to talk about the nuclear deals, to talk about Israel-Palestine, to talk about American life, which there were some people were curious about in the universities, but these town meetings, all they wanted to talk about was the Holocaust. And I finally said to them, I said, I know that you consider Israel your main enemy, but you have something fundamentally in common with Israelis. There are only two peoples on God's earth who only want to talk about the Holocaust, the Israelis and the Iranians. Well, finally I said, look, folks, it happened. It was horrible. You had nothing to do with it, so let's just move on. It was kind of insane. On a serious note, and I say this lamentably, it's impossible now to have a rational, sane, productive, useful discussion about the Nazi Holocaust. It's just been too politicized, too manipulated, too exploited, too commercialized, and too self-absorbed. it can't happen now. Maybe this phase of lunacy will eventually pass, and people can express authentic feelings about an authentic human tragedy. It's also, for reasons which were already stated, it's impossible to discuss it in Germany. Germany is just a passion play. It's just theater in Germany, beating their breasts. Oh, weren't they horrible? I can't bear it. It's so inauthentic. It's so false. It's so fake. And it has actually surprising results. It's true, as this young woman said, in public life, you're not allowed to criticize Israel. But when you look at the polls, the BBC World Service does a poll each year on where the most hated and the most respected countries in the world. And by far in Europe, 60% of Germans in any given year will list Israel as the most hated country. Yeah. They have this public image of being Philo-Semitic, but there is a reverse side which only comes out in the non-public polls. And the polls are very harsh. In my opinion, I don't want to be rosy-eyed, because I know everybody, it takes a long time to extirpate from one's personality and from a country's personality prejudices it carries. If you say 99% of white Americans carry racist feelings, that's just a fact. You can be politically correct till the end of time, but you still carry that baggage. The idea that you can extirpate it, even in several generations, is just false. And so the Germans carry that baggage. They have a long history of anti-Semitism, and they carry it. I remember during the build-up to the Gulf War in 2003, as some of you will remember, the German government opposed the U.S. attack. And I was on the Christine and Johansson show, what was it? It was the most popular.
Yeah.
And they were talking about the dangers to the Jews and blah, 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 blah. And I said, you know the joke. The joke goes, this world is turned into a crazy place. The best rapper is white, Eminem. The best golfer is black, Tiger Woods. And Germans don't want to go to war because they were the main opponents in Europe to the Blair, the Bush-Blair attack on Iraq. The main, I think, I could be wrong, and I'm willing to say, I acknowledge I could be wrong, but I think the main animosity of the Germans to Israel is not anti-Semitic. I think Germany, to its credit, it genuinely learned the lessons of World War II, and it became very anti-militarist. And Israel just has a profile of this kind of lunatic militarism. We grew up as young people. We grew up on John Lennon's "All We Are Saying Is Give Peace a Chance." And the Israelis is "All We Are Saying Is Give War a Chance, Another Chance, and Another Chance, and Another Chance." So I think the hostility of Germans to Israel, in my opinion, it's not predominantly anti-Semitic. It's predominantly anti-militarist. And Israel has just carved out a profile as a very militarist state. So I'm going to leave it at that. I have to take off, but I suspect I'll be seeing some of you tomorrow when I speak, and we'll be on to other topics and other issues.